Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110.
To honor copyright laws, we have removed some audio and video elements from this message. Now here's this week's message.
The Son's dying words to the world, words spoken through pain and great suffering, with passionate love to the ones He was dying to save, are the sum of His life and works. His gift to us, His heart, and the sound bites of God.
Well, good morning. Happy Easter. It's so good to have you with us. We've been in a series in Lent, which kind of leads up to Easter, where we've been looking at the seven words of Christ. He said seven things on the cross, pretty short. That's why we were calling them sound bites. Jesus said these just short phrases, but they had a lot of meaning. He said things like, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. Forgiving his executioners. He turned to a criminal right next to him being crucified and said, and pardoned him right there and then, and said, today you'll be with me in paradise. And he went through these different things as he was being crucified. And Jesus talked to his disciples. He said all along during his ministry with them, he said, hey, this, as a Messiah, I'm going to be crucified. And then 3 days later, I'll rise from the dead. So he communicated this from Good Friday to Easter. He said, this is how it's going to look. But they didn't get it. They didn't understand it all. They just kind of missed something. Has that ever happened to you? You're like, somebody's trying to talk to you and communicate something, and you think you understand it, but then you get it wrong, and then it ends up bad. That happened to me recently. And this past summer, I was wakeboarding. That's one of the things I like to do. I learned wakeboarding, though, behind a jet ski. Jet ski's pretty small. I didn't even know you could wakeboard behind a jet ski at first. And then somebody said, oh, yeah, you can do it. But there's really not a big wake in wakeboarding and then no wake. So that's how I kind of learned and did little jumps. And then this past summer, somebody in our church has a professional level wakeboarding boat. I mean, the ballast creates a huge wake. And so I'm on this wake, and it's pretty intimidating. You know, I'm trying to jump from one wake to the other, which is not an overly complicated trick. It just takes a lot of courage, especially when you're 53. You know, you're thinking to yourself, oh, you will live forever. You know, you have to pretend, you know, I'm like 20 years, 30 years ago. And so I'm not really doing that. I'm not very successful. I've landed it a few times, but I'm not hitting it right. So one of the people in the boat is my son, and he gives me some good advice. He's way better than me. He says, hey, listen, if you want to get more air, which is probably not a good idea for a guy my age, but I'm like, more air? Sweet. How do I do that? You know? And so he goes, well, what you're doing is you're going as fast as you can, but you're not really popping. He goes, you got to like launch, you know, like extend your legs, lock your knees, and you'll go way higher. So I thought, that sounds good. I'm going to try that. Now, this story doesn't end well, in case you're wondering, okay? So the boat goes again. I go way out. I'm coming in at the wake, and I'm right when I hit the crest, I think, it's my moment. So I do exactly what he said. You know, I popped, and I went higher. You know, I definitely got some more air. But I still didn't make it to the other side. And so I hit the wake wrong, and worst of all, see, he thought, he was only talking about my approach. He assumed I knew how to land still, so he didn't give me any coaching. So he didn't say anything about landing. And I was so fired up about all this air I had gotten, I forgot to unlock my knees. And so I hit this wake the wrong way, and I tore up my knee. So I tear the ACL, tear the meniscus. Just, I needed full, like, reconstructive knee surgery on my right knee. And so I'm in the middle of that rehab. It's over a year long of rehab. And I'm right in the middle of it, going physical therapy, all that stuff. Now, it wasn't my son's fault. He was communicating clearly. Hey, if you want more air, he wasn't talking about the landing. I missed something. This is what happened to the disciples. Jesus is communicating clearly. He's saying, as a Messiah, this is the way things are going to go down. I'm going to be crucified. I'm going to be betrayed, crucified, and then I'm going to rise from the dead 3 days later. He said that over and over. Maybe they thought he was being metaphorical. Maybe he thought that he was using symbolism. But in their minds, they were thinking, well, the Messiah is going to redeem Israel. What that meant to them was the Romans had this kind of oppressive government over them, and that he was going to throw off the Romans. And they were thinking it was going to be political, maybe military. That's kind of what they were geared up for. And they followed him. They liked Jesus. But then he goes and he gets himself killed. And they don't figure it out. They're going, what's going on? So all the disciples are messed up. So they're despondent. They're depressed. They're thinking, everything we thought we were going after has fallen apart. Now, this is the way it works sometimes, right? We get ourselves in a bad place. We find ourselves kind of like with a cloud over us, and bad things are happening, things are falling apart, and then we don't see God in that. We go, what happened? This isn't the way it was supposed to come down. I mean, I had all these bad things happen to me. It didn't happen to anybody else. It happened to me. It's not fair. I don't get it. And then we end up in a tough place. This is where the disciples were. And this is the day Jesus was raised from the dead. We're celebrating Easter, the very first Easter. They weren't happy. They were sad. And so he goes up to two of the disciples. We're going to look at this in Luke chapter 24. So if you have your Bible, turn to Luke chapter 24. I also have it in the outline that was given to you. You can pull that out, follow along. Luke 24 is Jesus coming to two of these disciples on Easter, and he's reaching out to them. Now notice there's four things that we pull from this passage, four things that are significant that he really does for us when we're down and out. Number one, Jesus looks for you. He looks for you. This is what he did to these guys. He's looking for them. He comes along. They're traveling on this road, and he comes to them. Beginning in verse 13, it says, now that same day, that's Easter, very first Easter. That same day, two of them, that's two of the disciples, were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and he walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. So here we have two of Jesus's disciples. Now we're told later one of them, his name is Cleopas. And we don't know the name of the other one. And maybe it's Cleopas. Some people say, well, that's probably Cleopas' wife. So it could have been a man and a woman. It could have been two guys. We don't know. But what we do know is it's not Peter and John. It's not like one of the main disciples. It's not the 12 disciples. It's Cleopas and the other guy. This is who he goes to. Right? I mean, now, for me, if I had been the Messiah and I had risen from the dead, I don't think these are the first two guys I'd hunt down. I'd probably go to like Caiaphas. You know, Caiaphas is the guy largely responsible for crucifying Jesus. The high priest, I'd go, hey, Caiaphas, it's me, Jesus. We got something to talk about, buddy, you know. I didn't like the way things went down just a few days ago. You've heard you can't keep a good man down, you can't keep a God man down. Or I'd go to Pontius Pilate. Go, hey, Pilate, remember you said you washed your hands of me? I'm back, buddy. You're probably thinking, I'm glad you're not the Messiah. Well, it's not like it was ever an option. I'm just saying, that's probably how I would have responded. I'd go around getting people back and stuff. Jesus doesn't. He's gone and he's restoring people. He goes up to people that we don't even know anything about them. Cleopas and another guy. He goes up and he looks for them and he connects with them. Now, this is remarkable. So this is Jesus. He's going to communicate to them, talks to these guys, and they're in this dark place. See, they're thinking, you know, Jesus is, in their minds, Jesus' mission has failed, and maybe he had gotten, you know, he could have gotten himself off the cross. He didn't, but they hear about this rumor that some of these women are talking about, that they went to the tomb and it was empty, and they saw Jesus. Some of the other disciples went, they go, they see the empty tomb, they don't see him. And so they're kind of just, they're lost in this place. They're thinking, yeah, I don't see how it's all going to work out. And they're hightailing it. They're leaving. And this is Satan's strategy. That when we get into a place of confusion, when we get into a place where of disillusionment, He starts to work his way in and causes us to leave. See, they're leaving Jerusalem. They're just getting away from the cross. They're just, and that's what happens sometimes with us. Maybe you're in a good place. Maybe you're reading the Bible, and then Satan will come up and go, hey, you know what? You don't need to read the Bible anymore. That's, you did when you were a kid, but you're above all that now. You don't need to keep praying. You know, you don't need to, you don't need the body, the bride of Christ to encourage you. You're good to go now. And if you believe that line of baloney, next thing you know, you fall spiritually. And then what happens? Satan comes back and he goes, and you call yourself a Christian. You know, what? Look at you. You're a fake. You're a phony. You're a hypocrite. You have no place in church. You need to keep away from those people because you're a phony and you know it. And see, both of those things have the same thing in common. Stay away from the cross. Stay away from the cross. But don't you know, when you're in a bad place, that's the best thing to do is go to the cross. That's where we find grace. That's where we find the power of God and his love. And that's part of what happens in church. I've always thought of the church not as a museum for saints, but as a hospital for sinners. A place where we come together. We're all kind of broken, but we're seeing God's grace at work. And a lot of people don't go to church very often. You know, they say that people go to church around 3 times at least, right? When they're hatched, when they're matched, and when they're dispatched. Right? The first time they throw water on you, the second time they throw rice on you, the third time they throw dirt on you. But it doesn't have to be that way. In fact, the Bible says that we need each other and we encourage one another. I like this verse. I put it in your outline for you. Notice it says, let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but let us encourage and warn each other, especially now that the coming of the Lord is so near. Reminds me of the story of the husband and the wife. They're going to church, and she's at the door. She looks back. She notices her husband has not lifted a finger to get ready to church. So she goes, hey, we're going to church. He goes, well, I'm not going. She goes, why? He goes, well, I'll give you 3 reasons. Number one is really the congregation, they're cold. Number two is nobody likes me there. Number three is I'm just not going to go. So she patiently listens to him. And she goes, well, let me give you 3 reasons why you should go. Number one is the congregation is warm. Number two, there are a few people there that like you. Number three, you're the pastor, so get dressed and let's go. So Satan, he tempts everybody, right? He says, hey, you shouldn't be there. You don't belong there. But the truth is we need one another. God it's a marathon, and we encourage one another. And so first thing is God comes, he looks for us, then he walks with us. Jesus walks with you. You know, there's a significant detail that's brought out about this story in one of the other Gospels, in the Gospel of Mark, when it says, afterward, Jesus appeared in a different form to 2 of them while they were walking in the country. And so Jesus appears in another form. Now, I don't think he had some kind of like disguise on, you know, like, you know, those cheesy glasses with the fake nose and the mustache. I don't think he's wearing some disguise. I think Jesus is, first thing, he's transfigured. He's in this resurrected body. Earlier that day when Mary of Magdalene saw him, she thought he was a gardener until he started talking, and then she realized, oh, this is Jesus. He's resurrected from the dead. And so here he is. He's in this resurrected body, or maybe they didn't recognize him because they were so discouraged, so disillusioned. The last thing they would have expected was God coming into their lives in a significant way. And that's true, right? I mean, that's when we get in a dark place. Sometimes we just don't even recognize God's hand. He's involved in our life, and we don't see it. Jesus is right there with them. Maybe it's because he had been crucified and had been, Isaiah says he was marred beyond recognition. That was a prophecy 600 years before. So he had been scourged with a cat of 9 tails, had hundreds and hundreds of scars all over his body, nail pierced, thorns in his head. Maybe that affected what he looked like. Maybe you've seen people like that if you've ever been in a trauma center and you've seen how people looked so differently when they're traumatized. Well, Jesus has just been traumatized. We're not sure exactly, but he's there with them. He's walking with them. And that's the significant part of this. He's walking with him. He walks with us when we're in dark places. One of the famous Psalms, Psalm 23, David writes, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." You're walking with me. We don't always see it, but he is. He walks with us even when we're in dark places. Isaiah says, when you're in over your head, God says, I'll be there with you. When you're in rough waters, you will not go down. When you're in between a rock and a hard place, it won't be a dead end, because I am your God, your personal God, the Holy of Israel, your Savior. Then he says, I paid a huge price for you. That's how much you mean to me. That's how much I love you. I'd sell off the whole world to get you back. Trade the creation just for you. And those are some words of love. He cares about you. Now, only God can say that, because he is the creator of creation. He says, I'd trade it all just for you. I mean, it's almost unbelievable to think how much God loves us, how he'll search for us, he'll walk with us when we're in a tough place. I want you to hear the story of a member of our church who was in a pretty dark place. And through that, he discovered God's redeeming power in his life. Would you give George Bell Jr. a warm welcome, please?
Happy Easter, everyone. Good morning to everyone. My name is George Howard Bell Jr. I am the youngest of 13 children, three of which my mother birthed. Growing up, my life was surrounded by drugs and alcohol. My father sold and used both. My mother was a crane operator at a steel mill and worked double shifts most of the time. While she was gone, I would be constantly locked in my room while my father had other women and men there to drink and do drugs. So naturally, when my mom would come home, I would cling to her and receive physical abuse for doing so by my father. Shortly after, at the age of 8 or 9, my father left the household for good, never to return. Surprisingly, things got a lot harder afterwards, but my mother continued to try and build a life for us. She maintained for a while until one day, my father tricked her into doing drugs. He laced her cigarette with crack cocaine and laughed when she asked what it was. That ended up pulling my mother into the drug world and ruining our lives even further. Around the age of 12, she had become a serious addict and we had lost everything we had. I started playing basketball as a refuge and met a coach named Rob Evans and began to live with him and his family while my mom was going through her struggle. On my 13th birthday, I was giving money from Coach Rob and some of the team parents because they knew I had nothing. So I went home to check on my mother, and when I got there, I saw her walking down the street. It was nighttime, so I decided to follow her. She walked to Diggs Park Apartments, which is a notorious drug-infested area. I ran up behind her and I told her to come back home and that she would be okay. But she was determined to go get the drugs. Then this man that she was supposed to get the drugs from approached us. And my mom said all that she had was DVDs as payment. He snatched them away from her and told her that if she didn't perform a sex act on him, he would kill her and I. She started crying, fell to her knees praying for God to save us. The guy caught his gun back, stared for a while, and then walked away. After that horrific event, my mom started getting more involved in church. And from that day forward, my mom never used drugs again and began singing and writing songs for her church. But as I got older, I began to feel the effects of what I had been through. I met a lady named Toshiba, whom I had a high school crush on, and married her and started having children. I began using drugs recreationally, or so I thought, and eventually became a cocaine addict. I would steal money, I would steal the replacement money, and anything I could touch. My wife had no knowledge of how bad I was doing until one day I did so much drugs at a hotel, I lost my mind. I started pouring cocaine down my throat in an attempt to commit suicide. And when it didn't work, I walked to the nearest hospital and admitted myself. Sorry. I was evaluated and placed in a mental health facility. While I was going through this, my wife refused to go to work in the morning without coming to see me and eventually lost her job while doing so. Before I met her, she had her whole life planned out and my addiction took all of that away. So one evening, while I was laying in the facility, I began to look back over my life. I thought about my mother's struggle and how she was able to get through by prayer and trusting in Jesus. I fell to the floor and began crying out loud. In that moment, I asked for forgiveness and guidance. And most importantly, I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. My wife came and told me that we had lost our apartment and that we had to move immediately. So the next morning when I was released, while we had nothing, for some reason, I felt like we had everything. I went to the pawn shop where I used to take the things I would steal. The pawn shop owner asked me, what did I do for a living? And I told him I didn't have a job, and he gave me one on the spot. I walked out and applied down the street for an apartment and was immediately approved with no down payment. I started working the next day, and the owner asked, what did my wife do for a living? I told him she had lost her job, but that she had an accounting background. He told me to call her and that she would be given a job as well. We began picking up the pieces of our lives. Soon after all of this, the pawn shop owner hired a new employee named Jacob Gaines. At first sight, I knew there was something genuine and different about him, so I asked him, what makes you smile like that? And he said, Jesus. Just like that. And invited us to the vineyard. We came the following weekend, and we found that the same kindness that we saw in this new employee, we found in the people at Vineyard. Soon after, I was given an opportunity to serve our community, and so were my children and wife. Accepting Jesus has taken away all fear, confusion, and the pain of my past life situations. People who knew me, they don't even look at me in the same light. My wife and I still work together. We have been rebuilding our marriage and our family through the help of Christ Jesus. We were blessed to become homeowners in November, and everything good in our lives has been a direct result of accepting Jesus. So in conclusion, I want to end with a verse that has encouraged me through all the struggles I've been through and will continue to encourage me throughout my life. Isaiah 54:10 reads, though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you. Happy birthday, Mama. Thank you guys for listening.
Good job. So he walks with us. He will when we're in a tough spot. He looks for us. He walks with us even when we don't always see it. And then third, by giving us a grander vision. You know, that's what he does. He comes along to these disciples and he basically says, why are you so sad? And they're, he's basically saying, hey, you're looking at your problems instead of something bigger. See, we kind of drop to our problems and sometimes we just live in that place. All we can see is the problems in our life, the problems, the bad things that are happening. And God wants us to have a bigger vision. So he does that with these guys. He says, Jesus asked them, he says, what are you discussing together as you walk along? They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, are you only a visitor to Jerusalem And do you not know the things that have happened here in these days? What things? See, they still don't realize that they're talking to Jesus. They don't know that. About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who is going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. Now, Jesus had told them it was going to happen in 3 days. But they're like, you know, and it's the third day. It's like, you know, they fell out of the stupid tree and hit every branch on the way down. Like, what's the third day? And they're saying this to Jesus. They don't realize it, of course. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus. And then Jesus, so this is them telling all their woes. And so he then gives them a grander vision. He said to them, how foolish are you and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all of the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. So this is probably one of the best sermons Jesus ever gave, and only these two guys hear it. Right? He basically walks them a tour all the way through the Old Testament, showing how he could be found in that all. I mean, when I go to heaven, it's one of the first things I want to do is go, Jesus, hey, can I hear that Road to Emmaus sermon? Must have been pretty amazing. I mean, he certainly would have covered, you know, going back into Genesis when Abraham was offering his son Isaac as, you know, as a sacrifice. You know, this reluctant father but willing, this willing son, it was showing what was going to happen on the cross. That verse there in Genesis 22, it says, Isaac said to his father, Father, where are we going to find the sacrifice? Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a sacrifice. Not he will provide a sacrifice, he'll provide himself a sacrifice. He then would have gone to the Passover. And in the Passover, when in Exodus, when the unblemished lamb, the blood of that lamb was put on the doorpost, and the angel of death would pass over. And of course, that foreshadows what was going to happen as well on the cross. That Jesus' blood, because he was that unblemished Lamb of God. He was sinless. And when we put our faith in what happened at the cross, then we don't have the angel of death come into our life. Certainly we die, but we're raised with Christ in new life. That there's eternity of resurrection that's promised to all of us who put our faith in Christ. And then he would have gone to Numbers and said, well, that rock that was broken and living water came out, that was foreshadowing Christ. And then he would have maybe gone to Micah, where the Messiah was born. And he says, you, Bethlehem, you of little be among the thousands of Judah, yet you shall come forth of the origins from everlasting. Pointing to that. Or in Psalm 22, when he would have said, you know, that scripture starts out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He would have said, don't you remember that Jesus said that on the cross? Later in that same psalm, he says that you will be pierced in your hands and your feet. He goes, that happened at the crucifixion. Over and over, showing this is the Messiah. This is what it was. See, they understood the crown. They didn't get the suffering part. They understood that the majestic part, that he was king, but they didn't realize that it meant that there was a suffering servant that went along with that. So Jesus explains that all to them. He explains that, and it's literally Jesus. They don't realize it, but it's Jesus actually speaking to them. Has that ever happened to you when you know, maybe if you've listened to a message before and God starts to speak through that message? It's no longer just the preacher and you, but you know, you hear a message and you think, okay, I need to pay attention. Okay, so that's a hint for some of you, okay? I need to pay attention. And then you listen and you start thinking, okay, all of a sudden it's God speaking now. It's his words. It's no longer just the preacher. Some of you are going, yeah, I've had that happen, just not with you, Andy. Well, maybe that's the case. But regardless, you know, you've had that happen and God's speaking, and you start to realize, hey, it's not just me and my problems. God has a greater vision. He's got something bigger for me. And God starts to speak through that. And then he wants to give us a passion for living. That's the fourth thing that we pull from this passage. You know, a passion for living. How we live. To live a strong spiritual life. I mean, if you're not feeling well and you go to the doctor, the first thing they say to you is, well, first thing they say is actually they say, do you have any insurance? You know, right? But after that they go, okay, I want to take your temperature, right? Why? Because that is an indication of your health, your physical health. Well, how is your spiritual health? If you were to take your spiritual temperature, well, the Bible says that there's three temperatures that we can have. We can either be icy cold, we can be miserably lukewarm, or we can be piping hot. And there's Bible verses on that. For example, describing the icy cold, he says, because of your iniquity, the love of many will grow cold. He's talking about an unbeliever, somebody who doesn't have a faith. They're just kind of going through life doing their own thing. A non-believer. But then there's this miserably lukewarm, and Jesus has some harsh things to say about this temperature, this type of person. He says, you are neither cold nor hot. How I would rather you be one or the other. So because you are neither cold nor hot, but lukewarm, I will spit you out of my mouth. That's pretty drastic, right? He goes, the King James says, I'll spew you out of my mouth. The original language actually says, I'll vomit you. I mean, it's just like, I can't take this anymore. And that's kind of surprising, really, wouldn't you agree? I mean, again, if I was God, I would be thinking, okay, I don't want people cold. I don't want them, you know, non-believer. I don't want them to not have a faith. I certainly want them to be hot. But if I can't have hot, I'd settle for lukewarm rather than cold. I mean, that's kind of what I would think, but God doesn't say that. He says, no, that's the worst of them all. Why? Well, the reason is because if you're a non-believer, there's still hope that you'll come to a place where you realize you need a Savior and you'll put your trust in Christ. And then, of course, if you're hot for God, then you're following His mission that He's got for your life. You're excited to serve Him. You're seeing God at work in your life. But when you're lukewarm, you're actually in a place where you're lulled in. You have a little bit of religion, and it makes you passive. You kind of get inoculated from the real stuff. You've gone to church a couple times, and then you think you're okay. And then you actually get lulled into this place where you're no longer being used by God at all. And you think you are. You think you're fine. You know, and you might not say this specifically, but you think, okay, I go to, you know, church maybe from time to time, but then, you know, I'm going to do my own thing. I'm going to live my life however I want. But don't you know God is very interested in all of your life, no matter what you do with your life. If you're single, He's interested in your singleness. If you're married, He's interested in that. If you're a parent or a grandparent, He's interested in the parenting. He's interested in your sex life. He's interested in your career, your schooling, your leisure time, all the things. He wants to be part of that. And that's part of what it means to be piping hot. Notice here, these two disciples are talking about how they got re-engaged. And here's, it says, were not our hearts burning within us while He talked with us on the road and opened the Scriptures to us? He's saying our hearts got stirred up. They got hot again. They were cooling off a little bit. They were cooling off. And notice the way it happens is when God speaks to them. See, they had already been talking about Jesus. So it didn't happen when they were talking about Jesus. It didn't even happen when they talked to Jesus. It happened mainly when Jesus talked to them. You go, well, that's great. I'd like to have it. You know, have Jesus walk alongside and talk to me. Hello, I've got good news for you. That is what Jesus does. He comes alongside us and He speaks words of life. He does it through Scripture. He also does it through other people. He does it through prayer. And He speaks to us. We get like inclinations and visions, all kinds of things. God has as many people as there are on earth, there's that many ways God can speak to you. And He wants to speak to you. And that's how we get our hearts fired up. But He waits for us. See, the part of the story that we're going to end with, you'll see that He's waiting to be invited in. This is how it ends. He says, as they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if He were going further. But they urged Him strongly, stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over. So He went in to stay with them. So here Jesus indicates He was going to go on farther. You know, they're walking on this road and they get to Emmaus, and He goes, well, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to go on somewhere else. And they're going, what do you mean? You need to stay with us. No, I'm going to go. Hey, you guys have a good day. No, you got to come, and we got a house here. We'll build a fire. It's cold outside. Let's have a meal together. And then he comes in, right? He's kind of waiting to be asked. Have you done that before, right? Where you're kind of waiting, you're kind of insinuating, you know, and, you know, maybe you were in a situation where you came across a couple friends, and you go, hey, what's going on? And you really want to be with them, but you don't want to say that. Hey, I'm lonely. I want to be with you, right? So you just go, what's going on? What are you guys doing tonight? Oh, well, we were gonna go out and get something to eat. And then you go, oh, well, I'm hungry. Oh, well, good. You should go get something to eat, you know. Well, where are you going? Well, we're going down to this restaurant down the street. Oh, that's my favorite restaurant. Well, you should go sometime. Well, I would if somebody would just invite me, right? You're getting desperate at this point. But, you know, we say things and we're waiting for kind of, you know, this is what Jesus is doing here. He's waiting for them to invite him in. And notice there's a progression from the road to the village to a house, house to the table. He wants to be invited into all of our lives. Amen. This last verse on your outline, it's Jesus speaking, and he says this. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if you hear my voice and open the door to what? Well, he's talking about our lives, our heart. I will come in. That's his promise. All you need to do is open the door. And then he says he'll come in. And he partners with us in life. He looks for you. He walks with you. He gives you a grander vision. And then he helps you to live passionately for the thing he's created you for. You have a purpose, a specific purpose that he designed for you. And he wants to help you to live that out. And he's got all of this strength and resources for you. He's the creator of the universe. Could you imagine if, like, Bill Gates came up to a homeless guy and said, hey, I want to go into business with you. The guy goes, really? Bill goes, yeah, what do you got? He goes, well, this homeless guy goes, I've got a basket. And I got a couple of shirts. I got three shirts. Bill goes, okay, that's fine. I've got $86 billion. I'm the richest man on the planet. I made it from Microsoft. We're going to be business partners. Right? And then the homeless guy goes, well, you know, do you need all three shirts? I mean, these are, yep, that's the deal. The basket and the shirts and my billions and billions. It'd be crazy for the guy, right, to not do that. He said, stop arguing with him, right? Give him the basket. He's got billions and billions. And this is what God does to us. He comes along to us, and we've got our little basket. We've got our few things that we've collected. And he goes, I want to partner with you. I have a mission. I'm going to change your life. I'm going to give you a new purpose. I'm going to have you live with a grander vision. And we start arguing about the basket. And we don't get that he is the creator of the universe. He's got all the resources. But he invites us in. Now, we can choose to reject it. We can say, no, I don't want that. I'll pass. I'm going to do it on my own. If I mess up, that's on me. If I miss things, that's on me. Because you have free will. That's a scary thing, but you can do that. Or you can say, you know what? Why do that? It'll never be a better deal than what God offers. Peter Drucker talked, he's dead now, but he was the father of modern management, said when he heard about the gospel, he thought about it in business terms. He said, there's never a better deal out there than grace. I give nothing, and I get God's grace and his love and eternity. It's a pretty good deal. It's a pretty good deal. God says that's what he offers us. We just give our lives. You see, the difference between religion and what Jesus offers is religion is spelt D-O, what I do to try to earn points and work my way up some kind of moral ladder so that God will say, okay, you're good enough. What Jesus offers is spelt D-O-N-E, what was done on the cross. He made all of the access for us. All we do is accept it. It's that simple. That's why Jesus says even children can come to him. It's not complicated. It's coming and saying, I want what God offers through Jesus Christ. Now let's do that right now. This Easter 2017, I'm going to encourage everyone here, would you bow your heads with me? Let's close and we'll ask God to come into our lives. Would you bow your heads, everybody? I want all heads bowed. Heavenly Father, Holy Spirit, come. You do your creative, powerful work. It's not about me. But Lord, it's you're the words of truth. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for the music and for the Bible study we just did. Help us, Lord, now to make it make a difference. This is the moment of truth. You may have come here because somebody asked, or you heard about the church somehow and you found your way in here and you're just doing the Easter thing, but God has been speaking to you. Some of you, if you were to have your temperature taken, you are cold. You haven't put your faith in Christ, but you realize the need. You're realizing, hey, I need to do that. Why not do it today? In just a moment, I'm going to pray with you. Some of you are lukewarm. You just check a box. You punch a card. You say, okay, I've did my service. But it's more than that. He wants to cause your heart to burn brightly. Some of you are, you're like those disciples and you're just kind of walking away. You believe, but you're discouraged. It didn't work out the way you thought. All you can see your problems. And Jesus wants to come alongside you, give you a grander vision. He wants to give you that passion to live for again. Okay, it's time to pray now, okay? Right where you're at. This is a bold decision right now. There's spiritual warfare going on. But God says he wants you to invite him into his life, into your heart, into your life right now. Would you do that? Right where you're at, just say, Jesus Christ, I invite you into my life. Transform my heart. Lift my gaze above just the problems I see. Now you need to be honest and just say, God, forgive me for the things I've done wrong. My sin. Trying to do it on my own. With your grace, would you say that? Say, God, with your grace, with your help, I'm going to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.